In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Well, today we encounter in our readings the concept of being a friend of God. In Luke's Gospel, the very first chapter, he says, "O Theophilus, I take to write an account of all that has been said and all that you've heard about Jesus of Nazareth." And so he calls this man who he's writing the letter to, the gospel it's to, is Theophilus. And Theophilus is a very interesting name. Perhaps, maybe your name is Theophilus. But hopefully after you listen to this little homily, you'll all desire to be a Theophilus in some form or another. Because the name Theophilus simply means friend of God. And all of us who are Christians truly desire to be God's friend. In fact, Jesus says he calls us no longer servants, but he calls us friends. And so in our readings today, we encounter that Jesus in the gospel makes a very profound impression in the synagogue. Let me tell you a story. A long time ago, when I was about 16 years old, I became a Christian. And I was a young guy who was not necessarily looking for Christianity. I wasn't looking for Christ. As one person, I think the great Alexander Fleming, the founder of penicillin, said, "Sometimes people find what it is they're not looking for." And that was the case for me when I became a Christian. I was just being a young guy and living my life, and a friend of mine invited me to a revival. Southern Baptist, believe it or not, a Southern Baptist revival meeting. That's right, Southern Baptist. And I remember going and thinking, well, I'm just going to go get this guy off my back and I'll be done with it, you know. I got my own life, you know, and I'm not a religious guy. And so, you know, I believe in God my own way, but don't saddle me down with some doctrine or some creed. You know, and certainly don't tell me I got to go to church every Sunday, because that ain't happening. I got more important things to do with my time. Well, anyway, that one Sunday night, well, actually it was probably a Tuesday night if I remember correctly, a long time ago, 30-some-odd years ago, went into the church. And it wasn't like people, you know, ran up and said, "Hey, how you doing? God bless you. Great to see you." Most people looked around and go, what's he doing here? I was just that kind of guy. I wasn't that kind of guy that was a religious guy. And most people, when I walked in, did not give me the right hand of fellowship. That's for sure. Because they were scratching their heads thinking, what's this guy doing in church, especially our church? You know what? See that thing there? It's called a door. Maybe you need to just kind of use it. But something happened to me that night. Something very, very profound. It made an impression in my life. And that was that I felt this overwhelming sense of God's love flooding into my heart. I was hooked. You know, I was like, wow, Lord, I want you. And so I became really excited about Jesus. And the other thing that really made an impression was a guy named Wayne Surtis. And he was a guy, he was a regular guy. I think he was, you know, a couple years older than I was. He was going to go into the Air Force. And I'll never forget Wayne, because he also made an impression upon me as well. He made an impression because he was a true disciple of our Lord. And so when he went into the Air Force, I remember he took the moniker Theophilus. He wanted to be known to everybody as God's friend. And so when we look at the readings today, we see that the first reading makes an impression upon the people. They are being read God's law. And it says in this reading that they started to cry. Now, we might wonder why they were crying. Were they crying because they were overjoyed? Were they happy? Perhaps. But were they crying because they're going, "Oh no, we got this law put on us"? It's probably like somebody coming back from a parole hearing. It's like, "Oh, this wasn't good. 3-year denial, 4-year denial, 2-year denial, even a 1-year denial. How can they do that to me? And so maybe it was the fact that the law was being placed upon them, and that was very, very terrifying to them. And yet they're told, do not be sad. Do not be downhearted. Today is a great day. The joy of your love, the Lord, must be in your heart, must be your strength. Today, eat rich foods and drink sweet wines or sweet drinks. Celebrate. Celebrate the law of God. Why? Because the law of God is not meant to bring death and destruction. It's meant to bring liberation and new life. We are told in the second reading that we are part of the body of Christ. We are many members. Although we are many members, we are one body. And the reality is that Christ is present. He's present, believe it or not, in His law. Jesus came to fulfill the law. So He makes that law perfect and present and enables us to live the law of Christ. He is present in His church. And He's present in us. So when we read Jesus saying the beautiful words from Isaiah about setting liberty to captives and the recovery of sight to the blind and, you know, the good news is preached to the poor and prisoners are set free. And after Jesus, now it's interesting, Jesus specifically read that passage. He sought it out. He didn't just, someone handed it to Him and said, oh, here, Jesus, read this. No, Jesus took the scroll and he kind of like, okay, I'm going to find what that's it right there, Isaiah. And He wanted to say that particular scripture because why? As when He sat down, He wanted everyone to know that now this Word of God, this living Word of God is now married with the eternal Word of God. In other words, Jesus is now truly present. He has brought the Word to life. That's what Catholics believe. Sometimes people think that Catholics are bound by religious laws and empty ceremonies. And yet, if you study the Catholic faith, you'll understand that Jesus is present to us in a very special and unique way. He fills us with His very self through the sacraments. The sacraments aren't just magical things. They are God's gift of grace imparted to us to bring forth eternal life. Jesus makes a true, indelible impact on each of us. Let me tell you one more story. Long before I became a Catholic, I remember going to my very first Mass. And I was checking out this little novitiate up in Northern California, and I was a college student, and I was hungry. College students are usually hungry because they're poor. And so I was checking this place out, and this guy, this little priest, comes out and says, "Hi there." Not, "What are you doing here? Get off, this is private property. Move it, bub." He just walked up and said, like he'd known me all my life, "Hi, how are you doing?" So he says, "Hey, what can I show you around?" He showed me around the premises. And then he turns to me and says, "Hey, would you like to stay for dinner?" And I said, "Sure. Is it free?" And then he said, "But first we have to go to Mass." And I went, Mass. Oh, well. I guess I could handle that, you know, and just sit in the back and be quiet. But let me tell you, one of the most profound things ever happened in my life. There I was, kneeling with the other brothers or monks, I guess you could call them, religious. And all of a sudden, when the priest held up the Eucharist, he said, "Behold, this is Jesus, our friend, our brother, in our midst. Happy are we who are called to His supper." Wow! Talk about making an impression. Sure made an impression upon me. I didn't realize that what Christians have believed for centuries is what they still believe today in the Catholic Church. That Jesus doesn't just speak His word in a book, but now He brings it to life like He does in Luke's gospel. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.